welcome to JD Advising's MPRE Crash Course. My name is Megan Jabouri, and I'm our lead course instructor and tutor, and I'll be leading the way during this crash course. Before we dive into the rules, I first want to talk about some of the basics. Many people sign up for the MPRE, and they really don't know what it's all about. So first things first, the MPRE stands for the Multi-State Professional Responsibility Examination. And it tests mainly the ABA model rules of professional conduct. This is a 60-question, 2-hour, multiple-choice exam. They score 50 out of the 60 questions, meaning 10 out of the 60 questions are experimental in nature. You should do your best to answer as many questions as you can. Finally, this exam is administered at Pearson View Testing Centers. Thus, this is an exam that's administered on the computer rather than with the Scantron and a pencil. This exam is administered 3 times a year. In terms of scoring of this exam, you should be sure to check with your local jurisdiction's requirements. Each jurisdiction sets its own passing score, and you want to make sure that you're achieving what is required of you in the place or the places that you're seeking to get licensed. But on average, to achieve most jurisdictions' passing scores, you want to aim to get about a 56 to a 60% correct on your practice tests. This means if you're taking a 60-question practice test, you're aiming to get 34 to 36 of 60 questions correct. And again, on average, that will give you a passing score in most jurisdictions. To answer another question that we get asked frequently, how should you prepare for the exam? We recommend that you memorize the rules as best as you can. Many people just jump right in to practicing multiple choice questions, and they unfortunately fall short, and they're not successful when they take this test. This exam can be very challenging. Many of the questions test the plain language of the rules, which means you have to have them memorized. So we recommend that you spend some time with the rules and that you really understand what they mean, then memorize, then practice. Be sure you're not skipping over that step of memorization. I promise it will be worth the effort when you get that passing score, when you ultimately take this test. So now that you understand the basics about the MPRE, let's jump into our crash course. If you're following along with me using our JD Advising MPRE outline, turn to the back of the outline where you can find our MPRE outline cheat sheet. It's a few pages long. It does not cover every single rule that could be tested, but we have hand-selected some rather highly tested rules from each subsection of the rules. So I'll not only be covering these, but I'll sprinkle in some examples along the way. Turning to the first subsection of our rules on our cheat sheet, the regulation of the legal profession. This subsection of the rules makes up 6 to 12% of your total exam. And the first rule that we come to is all about the regulation of lawyers. The rule tells us that lawyers are subject to regulation by each state where they are admitted to practice. And this is regardless of where they are practicing or where their conduct in question has occurred. When it comes to discipline, a lawyer is subject to discipline where he or she is admitted and where their conduct occurs. So just to stop there and to give you a quick example, let's say a lawyer is admitted to practice law in states A and B, and lawyer steals her client's money in state A. This rule says though the bad act occurred in state A, because this lawyer is licensed to practice law in states A and B, the lawyer can be subject to discipline in both places, states A and B, even though the lawyer did not do any sort of wrongful act in state B. The idea is a lawyer can be subject to discipline in multiple places for the same act. The next rule on our cheat sheet is all about admission. In order to be admitted to the bar, the burden of proof is on the applicant to establish their good moral character. Applicants are entitled to due process throughout the application process, but he or she may be denied admission if they've been convicted of a crime of moral turpitude, if they refuse to take an oath to uphold the Constitution, or if they refuse to act honestly in the application process. Our next rule is all about reporting, everyone's favorite rule. A lawyer who knows that another lawyer has committed a violation of these rules and that violation raises a substantial question to that lawyer's honesty, trustworthiness, or fitness as a lawyer must report it. Now, there are two minor exceptions. For instance, if this information is protected by confidentiality or if the information was gained through a lawyer assistance program. In those circumstances, if a lawyer comes to know of another lawyer's rule violation that raises that substantial question to their honesty, trustworthiness, or fitness as a lawyer, then they don't have to report it. A few things I want to stress before we move on. Please remember that this is a mandatory reporting requirement. Thus, if a lawyer has knowledge that another lawyer has committed a violation, and it's the type of thing that raises a substantial question to their honesty, their trustworthiness, or their fitness, the lawyer with knowledge of this violation has to report it. Let's say that Adam and Bob work at the same law firm as first-year associates. One day at lunch, Adam tells Bob that he has been double billing his client, ABC Corporation. He claims that he has to, or he's never going to reach his billable requirement. Bob wonders if he has to report Adam. Under the rule, yes. Adam told Bob that he was in fact double billing a client. So Bob has knowledge of this rule violation. Additionally, double billing your client, that's fraud. It is the type of thing that raises a substantial question to Adam's honesty, trustworthiness, and fitness as a lawyer. Thus, Bob has to report Adam, and if he doesn't, then he has committed a rule violation himself. Our next rule under the regulation of the legal profession is the unauthorized practice of law. The rule states that a lawyer may delegate work to non-lawyers, but they are ultimately responsible for the product. Further, the lawyer is supposed to be signing letters to their clients, opposing counsel, parties, or the court. Thus, if a lawyer has someone helping them draft a letter, like a law clerk, that's acceptable under the rules. But the lawyer is ultimately responsible for that letter and should be the person signing it. The next rule is multi-jurisdictional practice. Lawyers can practice in a place in which they are not licensed to practice law temporarily in four circumstances. If you like mnemonics, the one we have for this rule is RAMS, R-A-M-S. Turning to the R. This means it has a reasonable relation to the lawyer's practice in a place where he or she is licensed to practice law. Two, the A of RAMS is that the lawyer associates with another local lawyer who's actively participating in the case in the place in which he is looking to work on a temporary basis. The M of our mnemonic RAMS is that they're participating in some sort of mediation or arbitration that arises out of their home state practice. And then the S of RAMS stands for obtaining special permission to practice. So let me give you some quick examples. Turning to that R, that reasonable relation to where the lawyer is allowed to practice law. The example in our outline on this point tells us that officers of a multinational corporation survey potential business sites, and they seek the services of their lawyer who's not licensed in the jurisdiction in which they're surveying in assessing the relative merits of each. The lawyer can help them despite not being licensed in that jurisdiction in assessing the relative merits of each site. Why? Because it bears a reasonable relation to the lawyer's practice in the place in which they are licensed to practice law. Turning to the A of RAMS. Let's say a Michigan lawyer wants to represent a person in Wisconsin. If the Michigan lawyer teams up with a Wisconsin lawyer who's going to be actively participating in the case, the non-Wisconsin lawyer can do this. The M, that mediation or arbitration that arises out of a lawyer's home state practice. Let's say a lawyer in Michigan has a client that they represent, and the client gets themselves into a contract issue. The client wants to arbitrate this issue in Ohio and wants their lawyer to represent them. The Michigan lawyer can do that. And then finally, the S of RAMS. Let's say a Michigan lawyer wants to represent a client in Ohio. This means to get special permission, the lawyer needs to file a motion in that Ohio court where they would like to practice, seeking that court's permission. Turning to the next rule on our cheat sheet, non-lawyers. A lawyer must not form a partnership with a non-lawyer if any of the activities constitute the practice of law, nor can they incorporate with a non-lawyer absent special circumstances. Turning to partners and supervisors, the rules state that they must make reasonable efforts, that all of the lawyers and non-lawyers are following these model rules of professional conduct in their firm. When it comes to a subordinate lawyer, these guys are protected from violations of the rules so long as it's a reasonable resolution of an arguable question of professional conduct. In other words, the general rule is that subordinate lawyers are responsible for understanding and knowing these rules, and therefore, they're generally liable if they break the rules. The only exception is if they follow their supervisor's direction, and that direction appears to be a reasonable resolution of an arguable question. Now, turning to restrictions. A lawyer shall not participate in offering or making any sort of agreement that's going to restrict the right of a lawyer to practice law after the termination of that relationship, except if it's some sort of agreement concerning benefits upon retirement. Let's turn to a quick example on that point. Let's say a law firm offers a lawyer a senior partner position, and let's say it's a really great offer. As part of the employment contract, it requires the lawyer to agree that he will not practice law in this jurisdiction if he quits or if he gets fired. This is a violation of the rules. It's a violation for the law firm to ask this lawyer to agree to these terms, and it's also a violation of the rules for the lawyer to agree to the terms. We don't want to see that on either side here. And then the final bullet under the regulation of the legal profession is all about the sale of a law practice. The rule states that a law practice may be sold if the entire practice or an area of the practice is sold. If written notice is given to each of the clients, the fees charged to the clients do not increase as a result of the law firm changing hands, and the seller ceases to engage in the private practice of law or in that area of law. Next, turning to the second subsection of our rules, the lawyer-client relationship. This subsection of the rules makes up 10 to 16% of your total MPRE exam. So it's definitely an important portion of the rules. The first rule is all about formation. A lawyer-client relationship is formed when a person manifests an intent to hire the lawyer, and the lawyer agrees or they fail to make it clear that the lawyer is not going to be taking on the case. When it comes to decisions and who gets to decide what, the law tells us that clients get to decide things like their objectives and whether they want to settle, the expenses to be incurred, and if it's a criminal client, they get to decide a few additional things like whether to enter into a plea, to testify, and if they're going to waive a jury trial. When it comes to dealing with clients with diminished capacity, lawyers are supposed to maintain a normal lawyer-client relationship as much as possible. Now, when it comes to withdrawal, a lawyer must withdraw in three situations. One, if the representation of the client is going to result in a violation of these rules. Two, if the lawyer's physical or mental condition is materially impairing the lawyer's ability to represent the client in the instant matter. Or three, if the lawyer is fired or discharged by the client. Thus, there are only three instances in which the lawyer must withdraw. All of the other circumstances are permissive or mays. This means all of the other circumstances are situations in which the lawyer can, if he or she wants, but not musts. So a lawyer may withdraw if there's good cause. But either way, once a lawyer has withdrawn, they need to give reasonable notice to the client, refund any sort of advanced payment that's gone unearned, return papers to the client, and of course, allow the client to employ another lawyer in that matter. To give you a quick example about withdrawal, let's say a lawyer is diagnosed with a terminal illness, and most of the days he's confined to his bed. As a result, this causes the lawyer to miss many deadlines, and he's not able to represent this client well. In this situation, the lawyer must withdraw. Another example, let's say a client gets really mad at her lawyer, so she fires him. Well, in this instance, the lawyer must withdraw. Now, when it comes to communication with clients, the rules tell us that lawyers must, so this is mandatory, keep their clients informed about their case and promptly comply with any sort of reasonable requests for information. When it comes to fees, the fees that a lawyer charges a client must be reasonable, and they must also be communicated to the client in advance of the fees being incurred. Now, when it comes to contingency fees, there are special rules regarding these contingency fees. Specifically, these types of fee agreements require a writing, where other types of fee agreements do not. Thus, if a lawyer is entering into a contingency fee with the client, there are specifically two types of writings that are necessary to have an ethical contingency fee that's in compliance with these rules. The first is the agreement itself. It is the one that the parties enter into at the beginning of their case. This agreement should outline their fee agreement as well as the calculation of the ultimate fee. The second writing is a receipt. It's provided at the conclusion of the case. It usually states the outcome, the amount of money that's been recovered, the amount of expenses that have been incurred. It should outline how much the lawyer is entitled to, and of course, how much money the client is going to ultimately recover. Now, contingency fees are not allowed in all types of cases. Specifically, they're not allowed in family law cases or in criminal matters. Finally, the last rule is about fee sharing. The general rule is that lawyers from different law firms can share a fee only if the fee division is proportionate to the amount of work that's been done by each lawyer. The client agrees and the total fee charged is reasonable. So let me give you a quick example on this point. Let's say Bob is a solo practitioner and he has a personal injury case that's resulted from his client being subject to medical malpractice. And as this case progresses, he realizes that he needs some help. And Bob's friend Sam has years of medical malpractice experience. And Bob wants Sam's help. If Bob plans on paying Sam, he must get his client's permission. The total fee that he ultimately charges his client has to remain reasonable. And this fee-sharing agreement has to be done in proportion to the amount of work that each lawyer, both Bob and Sam, has completed on the case. Turning to the third subsection of our rules, client confidentiality. This portion of the rules makes up 6 to 12% of your total MPRE exam. The big takeaway from this section is that there are only three rules at play: the attorney-client privilege, work product doctrine, and our duty of confidentiality. So if you really spend some time memorizing these rules, you can maximize your chances of success with this subsection specifically. The first rule is the attorney-client privilege. The rule states that this is an evidentiary rule, and the whole purpose behind it is to prevent a court or some sort of governmental entity from compelling or using its powers to force the lawyer to reveal confidential information that's been exchanged between the client and the lawyer. Here the client holds the privilege, and it goes on for forever. It outlives the relationship between the parties. So just to stop here, the attorney-client privilege protects those confidential communications between a lawyer and a client. It allows the lawyer to assert this privilege on behalf of the client, meaning the client can waive it if they want. To give you a quick example, a lawyer is representing a client in a murder case. And in a meeting at the lawyer's office with only the client present and the lawyer present, the client admits to killing her boyfriend with a knife. This communication is privileged, and the lawyer cannot reveal this information. Now, if the court or the opposing party tries to compel it or they seek it, the lawyer must assert this privilege on behalf of the client, protecting this communication. Turning to the next rule, the work product doctrine. It's defined as materials prepared by a lawyer for litigation or in anticipation of litigation, and it's immune or protected from discovery unless the opposing party can show a substantial need and undue hardship. However, a lawyer's mental impressions are absolutely immune. This means that even if the opposing party can show that substantial need and undue hardship, the lawyer's mental impressions will always ultimately be protected and redacted from whatever is produced. The next rule is confidentiality. The rule states that a lawyer shall not reveal information relating to the representation of a client unless the client has given their informed consent or the disclosure is impliedly authorized in order to carry out that representation, or there's an exception that applies. Let's stop there. The language utilizes strong language. Thus, a lawyer must not reveal confidential information relating to the representation of a client unless they tell you you can, or unless you have that implied authorization. Now, as I mentioned, there are some exceptions. But before I dive into them, I think it's helpful to make a mental note comparing and contrasting the attorney-client privilege and our duty of confidentiality. The attorney-client privilege is narrow. It's only going to protect those confidential communications between a lawyer and a client. Whereas the duty of confidentiality is much broader because it's protecting all information that the lawyer has learned relating to the representation of the client, regardless of its source. Now, let's talk about those exceptions to our duty of confidentiality. If you like mnemonics or memorization devices, memorize the C's. So first things first, the rule says that a lawyer may reveal information in these instances, not must. The first C is certain death or harm, specifically to prevent reasonably certain death or substantial bodily harm. Let's say a lawyer learns that poison is inadvertently dumped into a town's water supply that will cause death if it gets ingested by anyone. The lawyer can, meaning may, so they don't have to, they can reveal this information. The next C, crime or fraud in which the lawyer's services have been used. Let's say a client uses his lawyer's services to fill out an application for a loan, and the client has given that lawyer fraudulent information in an effort to try to obtain that loan. The lawyer finds out that he's been given this fraudulent information that he's already put on that loan application and that he's submitted. Here, the lawyer can reveal this information because he has been used to further his client's crime or fraud. The next C is to determine compliance with these rules. So if a lawyer wants to try to secure legal advice about compliance with the rules, the lawyer can divulge whatever confidential information as is necessary to do so. However, the lawyer should never reveal who their client is. So let's say a lawyer is put in an ethical dilemma. Most states have an ethics hotline. The lawyer can call that ethics hotline, tell the other person the basics of their situation, again, not revealing who their client is, in an effort to try to obtain some help about what to do or how to move forward. The next C is a controversy between the lawyer and the client. If the lawyer has to, they can try to establish a claim or some sort of defense on their own behalf in a controversy with their client. Then they can reveal whatever confidential information that they need to reveal in order to do so. However, they are limited to revealing only what is necessary to protect themselves. So let's say a lawyer represents a client successfully, and the client never pays the lawyer. Once the representation has been terminated, the lawyer can sue the client for his fee, and the lawyer can reveal information about their fee agreement as is necessary to try to collect his fee. The next C is court order. This means lawyers can reveal confidential information as is necessary to comply with law or court order. Let's say a lawyer is trying to protect his client's medical records, and there's a discovery hearing on it, because the other party ultimately wants these records. If the court orders the lawyer to hand these over because the client has put one of his or her medical conditions at issue, which gives this opposing party the right to receive these types of records, then the lawyer has to follow the court order. It is always in the lawyer's best interest, however, to notify the client about the outcome and to try to explain that the lawyer needs to comply with the court order and to explore the possibility of an appeal. But ultimately, the lawyer has the ability to follow that court order. The final C, to detect conflicts of interest arising from the lawyer's change of employment or changes in the composition or ownership of a firm. Oftentimes, when lawyers switch law firms, or if law firms merge, they might encounter a conflict of interest. Lawyers also need to do their best to avoid conflicts of interest. In these instances, information about the clients, usually very basic information about the clients, can be revealed to try to avoid conflicts. Usually this information is very limited, such as the client's name and the type of case that was being handled for that client, and whether or not it's been resolved or if it's ongoing. Moving on to the fourth subsection of our rules, conflicts of interest. First things first, note that this is the most heavily tested subsection of the rules, making 12 to 18% of your total exam. So if you find yourself studying at the last minute, this is the subsection of the rules that you should first be focusing on. So the first rule that we have is all about current client conflicts. The rules are pretty clear. You shall not represent a client if going to is going to create a current client conflict. And current client conflicts arise in two situations. The first situation is if the representation of one client is going to be directly adverse to another. So for instance, you can never represent a plaintiff versus a defendant in the same case. The second type of situation that might arise is a little bit less obvious. Let's say an airline company hires a lawyer to defend them in a personal injury action. And let's say a woman comes to the same lawyer and asks him to represent her in a lawsuit against that airline in a wrongful termination claim. Here, while those lawsuits are totally unrelated, because the lawyer would essentially be representing the airline and then suing the airline, that's a problem. That would bring about a concurrent client conflict or current client conflict. The second situation in which we have a current client conflict is if there's a significant risk that the representation of one or more clients will be materially limited by the lawyer's responsibilities to another client, a former client, or a third person, or by their own personal interests. Thus, this usually comes about when a lawyer has been retained by a few people, usually for a business venture. And then one of those people being represented from that group asks the lawyer for their own personal advice. In this situation, there's a current client conflict because the lawyer owes a duty of loyalty to the group as a whole or that business venture, and therefore can't best advise just one of those group members because that advice might be contradictory to his duty owed to the group as a whole. Now, there is a way around this rule. The law tells us that lawyers can move forward with representation if they reasonably believe that they can provide competent and diligent representation, as long as the representation is not prohibited by law, and if it's not client against client. You can never ever represent client against client. And each client must give their informed written consent. Turning to our next rule under conflicts of interest, former client conflicts. The rule says that a lawyer who's formally represented a client in a matter shall not thereafter represent another person in the same or substantially related matter in which the person's interests are materially adverse to the interests of the former client, unless the former client gives their informed consent confirmed in writing. For example, let's say a lawyer represents a client in drafting a contract. The lawyer cannot seek to rescind that contract on behalf of a new client. Turning to the note about substantially related, this means they involve the same transaction or confidential factual information. The next rule is all about clients of a lawyer's former firm. The rules state that a lawyer shall not knowingly represent a person in the same or substantially related matter in which a firm with which the lawyer was formerly associated previously had represented a client whose interests are materially adverse to that person, and about whom the lawyer has acquired information protected by the duty of confidentiality that's material to the matter, unless the former client gives their informed consent confirmed in writing. The next rule is all about prospective client conflicts. So even when a lawyer-client relationship does not ultimately result, a lawyer who has learned information about a prospective client cannot use that information nor reveal that information unless an exception to the duty of confidentiality, which we've already covered, applies. Additionally, a lawyer shall not represent a client whose interests are materially adverse to that of a prospective client in the same or a substantially related matter if the lawyer received information from that prospective client that could be significantly harmful to that person in the matter. To give you an example, let's say a woman comes to a local law firm to have a free consultation regarding a car accident that she was involved in. But the woman does not ultimately end up hiring that law firm. Later, the other driver in this car accident comes to that law firm and wants to hire them. This is a problem, and that law firm cannot move forward in that representation of the other driver due to this prospective client conflict. Turning to the rule of imputed conflicts. When lawyers are associated in a law firm, none of them shall knowingly represent a client when one of them practicing alone would be unable to represent that client due to the conflict of interest rules. This is unless the conflict of interest is a personal conflict of interest and does not pose a significant risk of materially limiting the representation of the client by the remaining members in the law firm. Or it's based upon a conflict with the former client, with the lawyer's former firm, and the lawyer is screened off of the matter. Here, when we say screened off the matter, this means the lawyer is not able to participate in the matter, they're not given any part of the fee from that matter, and written notice is provided to the affected former client that this whole screening process is taking place. To give you an example about an imputed conflict, but more specifically one that is personal and therefore wouldn't be necessarily imputed to the rest of the firm. Let's say that a client is in a romantic sexual relationship with a lawyer. While that lawyer would technically have a personal conflict of interest with that client and would not be able to represent that client, the other members of the law firm could, because that type of conflict of interest is personal to the involved lawyer. And it's not the type of thing that would impact the other lawyer's abilities to represent that client. Now, to give you an example of lawyers switching firms and how there could be an imputed conflict by virtue of a lawyer's previous client from their previous firm. Let's say a lawyer comes from law firm one with having previously represented car company A. The lawyer goes from law firm number one, where car company A was the client, to law firm number two, where they are now employed, and car company B, which is a competitor with car company A, wants to hire law firm number two. Technically, this would be a problem. This would be a conflict of interest by virtue of that lawyer moving from law firm number one, where car company A was a client, to law firm number two. However, in this instance, law firm number two could still take on car company B as a client, but in order to do this, they would have to screen off that lawyer who has that conflict of interest. And again, car company B would have to be notified of this as well as car company A. The lawyer would not be able to participate on the matter and would not be able to get paid or get a fee from that client matter. Turning to transactions with clients, specifically bullet number one, business transactions. The law tells us that a lawyer shall not enter into a business transaction with a client or knowingly acquire an ownership or possessory or security or other pecuniary interest that's adverse to their client unless they follow the following requirements. First, the whole transaction has to be fair and reasonable to the client. Two, the client has to be advised in writing of the desirability of seeking and given the opportunity to seek independent legal counsel on the transaction. And finally, the client has to give their informed consent in a signed writing to the essential terms of that transaction, as well as the lawyer's role in that transaction. including whether or not the lawyer is representing the client in that transaction. Turning to the next bullet about using information. Here under the conflict of interest rules, the law tells us that a lawyer shall not use information relating to the representation of a client to the disadvantage of a client, unless the client gives their informed consent or is otherwise permitted by the exceptions to these rules. When it comes to gifts, gifts can create a conflict of interest. Thus, a lawyer shall not solicit any sort of substantial gift from a client, including testamentary gifts, or preparing on behalf of a client an instrument that gives the lawyer or a person related to the lawyer any substantial gift, unless the lawyer or other recipient of the gift is related to the client. So this means you can write your parents a will, even if they're going to give you something in the will. That's fine because you're related. But you cannot write a will for your longtime client that you are not related to if they're going to be leaving you a gift in that will. The next bullet here is all about literary or media rights. The rule tells us that prior to the conclusion of the representation of a client, a lawyer shall not make or negotiate an agreement giving that lawyer literary or media rights to a portrayal or some sort of account based upon that representation. Thus, let's say a big movie star hires a lawyer to represent him in his high-profile divorce case. And this movie star is running out of money because this has been a long, drawn-out case. He realizes that he's running out of money, so he offers to his lawyer literary and media rights. In other words, he can go on and explain his story. He could write a book and try to make money off of this representation of this high-profile case. Here, the problem with this situation is that the lawyer cannot negotiate this type of agreement with the movie star while this divorce case is ongoing. Doing so in negotiating this type of agreement would be unethical and would arise to a conflict of interest under the rules. Our next bullet is about financial assistance. Lawyers are not supposed to provide financial assistance to their clients in connection with any sort of litigation or contemplated litigation, except for the fact that lawyers are always allowed to advance fees and court costs, which should ultimately be the client's responsibility. The only exception to this rule is if the client happens to be an indigent client and the lawyer is going to pay for these things himself. When it comes to proprietary interests, these rules state that a lawyer shall not acquire a proprietary interest in the cause of action or in the subject matter of the litigation at hand. Exceptions include things like contingency fees or a lien to obtain a lawyer's fee. When it comes to being compensated from a third person, this too could create a conflict of interest. The law tells us that we are only permitted to accept payment from a third person, meaning not the client, if the client gives informed consent and there is no interference with the lawyer's independence or his or her professional judgment as it relates to this client case or with the lawyer-client relationship. And information relating to this representation is kept confidential. In other words, the lawyer cannot share this information with the person who's paying him or her in connection to that representation without the client's consent. When it comes to malpractice liability, first things first, a lawyer shall not make an agreement that prospectively limits the lawyer's obligation for malpractice to the client, unless the client is independently represented in entering into and making the agreement. This is a really important rule. This is actually the only rule where your client must be independently represented in entering into this type of agreement. Thus, if a client wants to hire a lawyer, but the lawyer says the only way she will take on this client's case is if the client waives any potential malpractice claims, the only way these two people could move forward with that type of agreement is if the prospective client goes out and actually gets independent representation in the making of that agreement. If not, and if that client refuses to hire another lawyer in the signing of that agreement, then the lawyer cannot enter into that type of agreement with the client because the client has to be independently represented for this agreement to be ethical. When it comes to settling a claim, a lawyer shall not settle a claim with an unrepresented client or former client, unless that person is advised in writing of the desirability of seeking independent counsel in relation to the settlement, and also given a reasonable opportunity to actually do so. When it comes to sexual relationships, lawyers shall not have one of these with a client, unless it's a consensual relationship that existed between the two of them when that lawyer-client relationship commenced. Again, this is a personal conflict of interest, and it's not the type of thing that's going to be imputed upon the other members of the lawyer's firm. The next rule is about lawyers moving into the private sector after government work. The law tells us that these lawyers are subject to all of the conflict of interest rules that we've been discussing, and they might not otherwise be able to represent a client in connection with a matter in which they participated personally and substantially as a public officer or employee, unless the appropriate government agency gives their informed consent, confirmed in writing, to that representation. To give you some guidance regarding this rule, the word matter has been interpreted to be very narrowly defined, meaning specific facts and specific parties. It only covers information that the lawyer actually obtained. When it comes to judges, a lawyer shall not represent anyone in connection with a matter in which the lawyer participated personally and substantially as a judge or other adjudicative officer or law clerk, or as an arbitrator or a mediator or any other type of third party neutral, unless all parties to the proceeding give their informed consent confirmed in writing. The only exception to this is if you were serving as an arbitrator, specifically a partisan arbitrator, on a panel. In that instance, then you could go on to serve a party because it's very clear that you're not taking a neutral posture over the case. So to give you a quick example here, let's say there's a mediator that's working on a family law case, specifically trying to mediate a divorce between a husband and a wife. Later, the wife approaches that mediator and says, "I want to hire you to represent me in my divorce against my husband." The mediator cannot do that unless that mediator gets the informed consent, confirmed in writing, from both the husband and the wife. Turning to the next subsection of our rules, competence, legal malpractice, and other civil liability. This subsection of the rules makes up 6 to 12% of your total MPRE exam. There are two main rules that we're going to discuss. The first is all about competence and diligence. The rule states that a lawyer shall provide competent representation and exercise diligence and care. This includes being prompt and not procrastinating. Procrastinating on a client issue can lead to lots of ethical and legal trouble for a lawyer. Turning to malpractice, a plaintiff has to be able to establish duty, breach, both types of causation, so actual and proximate, and harm, in order to successfully sue a lawyer for malpractice. Malpractice claims can be very challenging for a plaintiff or a past client to win against a lawyer, because oftentimes proving causation is very, very challenging. This is because they would have to prove that they would have received a favorable outcome absent the lawyer's negligence. You should note that the rules expect you to know the difference between malpractice and attorney discipline. If a lawyer gets disciplined, this means that he or she could be fined by the state bar, their license could be suspended, or they could even be disbarred. In other words, it's all about disciplining the lawyer for doing something wrong or violating these rules. That's different than a malpractice action. A malpractice action is when the client sues the lawyer and is essentially saying, "You messed up, and but for your mess up, my case would have been successful." The idea behind a malpractice lawsuit is if the client is successful, any sort of recovery is going to flow to that client. Where if a lawyer is successfully disciplined, the client doesn't actually obtain anything from that, other than maybe satisfaction in knowing that their lawyer was in fact caught or disciplined. Turning to an example on this point, let's say that a client hires a lawyer to file a personal injury case on her behalf. And let's say that lawyer is very absent-minded and overworked, and the statute of limitations runs on the client's case. If that client reports the lawyer to the state bar, it's very likely the state bar would take successful disciplinary action against the lawyer, which again could mean many different things. It could be a fine. It could be a suspension of the lawyer's license, or it could be disbarment. Now, if that client chooses to sue the lawyer for malpractice, the client would have to show that the lawyer owed her a duty, which would probably be pretty easy since they have entered into this lawyer-client relationship. The client would have to show a breach, which again would probably be pretty easy if the lawyer simply failed to file the lawsuit timely. But causation could be harder because the client has to prove actual causation and proximate causation. In other words, here the client has to prove that but for the lawyer missing that statute of limitations, they would have been successful and they would have won their lawsuit. And that's a very challenging thing to prove. Of course, the client's been harmed because they were not able to have their lawsuit heard. Turning to the next subsection of the rules, litigation and other forms of advocacy. This is a rather heavily tested subsection, making up 10 to 16% of your total MPRE exam. The first rule we will cover is that a lawyer may only bring a claim if there's some sort of basis in law and fact, and the claim is not frivolous. The next rule is all about candor to the tribunal. The law tells us that lawyers shall not knowingly do three things. The first is make false statements of fact or of law to the tribunal, or fail to correct statements of material fact or of law that has been previously made to the tribunal. To give you an example, if the court asks a lawyer whether or not his client has a criminal record, and the lawyer knows that the answer is yes, but says no, then the lawyer has breached his obligations under this rule. The second portion of the candor to the tribunal rule says that failing to disclose to the tribunal legal authority to be controlling in the jurisdiction known to the lawyer that's directly adverse to the position of his client and not disclosed by opposing counsel. What this rule means is that if a lawyer knows that the opposing party is not or has not disclosed controlling authority that hurts his client's case, that lawyer has to make this information known to the court, even though it hurts his client's case. The third portion of candor to the tribunal says that a lawyer shall not knowingly offer evidence that the lawyer knows to be false. If the lawyer or the lawyer's client or a witness that the lawyer calls has offered material evidence and the lawyer comes to know of its falsity, the lawyer shall take reasonable remedial measures, including, if necessary, disclosure to the court. To give you an example, let's say a lawyer represents a client in a case against the government regarding a taking. This is a situation where the government has taken land from a private person and tries to give them just compensation as a result of the taking. Let's say that the client testifies that his land that was taken is worth $100,000, but later the lawyer finds out that it's really only worth $50,000. So the lawyer asks the client to correct this information, but the client refuses. In this instance, the lawyer has to correct this information or has to disclose it to the tribunal. When it comes to ex parte proceedings, this is a situation where only one side of the lawsuit is present. In this instance, the lawyer has a heightened obligation to make sure that the court has all of the facts that are pertinent in front of it to allow the court to make an informed decision. This is true even if the lawyer has to disclose facts that may harm his client's position. They must do so in an effort to be transparent because it's an ex parte proceeding. A lawyer shall not be communicating orally with a judge ex parte without the other side present unless they're given advanced notice to the other side. If there's written communication, this is okay so long as a copy of that communication is sent to the other party. When it comes to fairness to opposing parties and counsels, this is a rather loaded rule, but it tells us that a lawyer shall not unlawfully do things like obstruct justice, falsify evidence, or offer an inducement to a witness that's prohibited by law. The classic example here is you can't offer a contingency fee to an expert witness. That's not ethical. Instead, you would have to pay your expert witness a flat fee or some sort of hourly fee. You cannot knowingly disobey an obligation or make frivolous discovery requests. At trial, a lawyer cannot allude to any matter they do not reasonably believe to be relevant or admissible. They're not supposed to assert personal knowledge of facts that are at issue, except if they're testifying as a witness, or state a personal opinion as to things like the justness of a cause, the credibility of a witness, or the guilt or the innocence of the litigants or the defendant. The next rule is about jurors. The rule is pretty clear that we as lawyers shall not communicate with any juror on the case in which you are involved on any subject. So if it's a criminal case, it's not okay to discuss the weather with a juror. You're not supposed to be communicating or talking to them at all. When it comes to trial publicity, we know that the public is interested, especially in things like criminal matters. Here, the rule says that a lawyer who is participating or has participated in the investigation or litigation of a matter shall not make extrajudicial statements that the lawyer knows or reasonably should know will be disseminated by means of public communication and will have a substantial likelihood of materially prejudicing the adjudicative proceeding in the matter. So to give you a quick example, let's say a prosecutor makes a statement to the news that the defendant in question failed a polygraph test in a murder case that is currently ongoing. This comment or statement would be considered unethical. One usually cannot speak to the result of a test, for instance, like a polygraph test or a lie detector test, or the failure of a person to take a test. So here, if the prosecutor is making some sort of announcement to the news, it's definitely clear that this type of statement would be publicly disseminated by virtue of the fact that it's being provided to a news outlet or the media. And this definitely would be the type of thing that would materially prejudice the criminal proceeding. So in this example, the prosecutor has most definitely violated the rules. There is an exception to the rule, which we call the right of reply. The law tells us that a lawyer can make a statement that a reasonable lawyer would believe is required to protect his client from substantial, undue prejudicial effect of recent publicity that was not initiated by a lawyer or the lawyer's client. So to use that previous example with the prosecutor who made those unethical comments to the news or to the media, the lawyer that is representing the defendant in that case would be able to make a response, hence the right of reply, also to the media in an effort to try to clear the air and to protect his client. The final rule is all about lawyers as witnesses. The general rule is that a lawyer shall not be a lawyer in a case and also be a witness in the same case if they are likely to be a necessary witness. Now, there are some exceptions. A lawyer can be a lawyer in a case and still be a witness in that case if they're going to be testifying to an uncontested issue, or if the testimony relates to the nature and the value of the legal services at hand, or if disqualification of the lawyer is going to pose some sort of undue substantial hardship upon the client. But the general rule is that a lawyer should be the lawyer and not also be the witness in the same matter. The next subsection of the rules are all about transactions and communications with people that are not your clients. This portion of the rules makes up 2-8% of your total exam. The first rule states that in the course of representing a client, a lawyer shall not knowingly make a false statement of material fact or of law to a third person, or fail to disclose a material fact to a third person when disclosure is necessary to avoid assisting in a criminal or fraudulent act by the client, unless disclosure is prohibited by the rules of confidentiality. So to give you an example on this point, let's say a lawyer is representing a client in a jurisdiction where failure to reveal known asbestos is a crime. Specifically, this lawyer is representing the client in the sale of one of his commercial buildings. The client fills out the necessary real estate disclosure forms, saying that there is not asbestos on the property. However, the client and the lawyer know that there is, in fact, asbestos that's been found on the premises. In this instance, failing to disclose this information, as I noted, is a crime, Thus, the lawyer cannot allow the client to lie on this form. If the client does so, the lawyer needs to take steps to disclose this information or to clear the air. The next rule is about communication with represented people. While representing a client, a lawyer shall not communicate about the subject matter of the representation with a person that they know to be represented by another lawyer, unless the lawyer has consent from the representing lawyer to speak to their client, or unless they've been authorized to speak to that represented party by law or by court order. If a lawyer learns that the person that they're speaking to is represented by counsel, they should stop speaking about the subject matter of the representation immediately. The final rule under this subsection is communication with unrepresented people. Lawyers can communicate with those that are not represented. This makes common sense because if someone hasn't hired a lawyer, how are you supposed to communicate with them? Thus, lawyers can communicate with those people who are unrepresented, but they cannot state or imply that they're disinterested in the matter. Accordingly, a lawyer cannot call the unrepresented opposing party and say, "I just want what's best for everyone," because that implies that they're disinterested, and that is not ethical, because the lawyer is very interested by virtue of his representation of the other party. Turning to the next subsection of the rules, different roles of the lawyer. This portion of the rules makes up 4 to 10% of your total exam. Lawyers can act as advisors. And when lawyers have their advisor hats on, they're supposed to be rendering candid advice to their clients, even if it's the type of thing that their client doesn't necessarily want to hear. When lawyers work as an evaluator, lawyers can provide evaluations of a matter that affect their client for the use of someone other than their client, if the lawyer reasonably believes that the making of this evaluation is compatible with other aspects of the lawyer's relationship with the client. Now, if the lawyer knows that this information at hand is going to affect the client's interests in a material and adverse way, then the lawyer should not be providing this evaluation or its information unless the client has given his or her informed consent. For instance, if a lawyer is representing a client in the sale of a piece of property, and this lawyer hires a surveyor and an inspector to evaluate the land, the evaluations are very favorable, and let's say it makes the land more valuable. In light of this, the lawyer can reveal this type of information to a prospective purchaser. Now, if the lawyer receives information that's going to impact the value of the land negatively, then the lawyer should not reveal this information without getting the client's informed consent. Lawyers also work as negotiators. When lawyers are involved in negotiation, they can engage in what we call puffing or puffery. However, they must not make false statements of material fact when they negotiate. Lawyers can also act as arbitrators and mediators or as other types of third-party neutrals, but they need to make it very clear to the unrepresented parties that they are acting as a neutral and that they're not representing those unrepresented parties. And it's also true, as I previously mentioned, under our conflict of interest rules, that a lawyer cannot later represent one of those clients after they've acted neutrally with respect to them without getting informed consent from all of the parties involved. Turning to prosecutors and government lawyers, prosecutors have a heightened sense of ethical obligation under these rules. This is because they are considered a minister of justice. They're not supposed to prosecute a charge that they know is not supported by probable cause. They have to make sure that the accused in the criminal matter knows that they have a right to retain counsel. And they have to make timely disclosure to the defense all evidence or information that they have that tends to negate the guilt of the accused or to mitigate it in some way. This is called the Brady Rule. Thus, the law requires the prosecutor to hand over mitigating evidence. When it comes to a lawyer representing an organization, for instance, like a corporation, lawyers owe a duty of loyalty to the organization and not necessarily the people who run it. This can be confusing because corporations aren't people, but instead they're ran by people. Therefore, when a lawyer is hired to represent a corporation, the lawyer needs to keep in mind that his duty of loyalty is running to the corporation itself, and he should want what is in the best interests of the corporation, not necessarily the board of directors. Accordingly, if a lawyer for an organization knows that a person associated with that organization is acting or is going to act in a manner that is in violation of a legal obligation to that organization, or some sort of violation of law that might reasonably be imputed upon this organization, and it's likely to result in some sort of substantial injury to the organization, then the lawyer shall move forward as reasonably necessary in the best interests of that organization. This usually means that the lawyer in question is going to take this information that they have and refer it up to the highest authority that can take action on behalf of that organization. They may also be able to report this information outside of that organization if they reasonably believe that there's been some sort of clear violation of law that's reasonably certain to result in a substantial injury to the entity or to the organization. To summarize this rule generally, a lawyer has the obligation to report up and may report out in some instances. For instance, if a lawyer represents a corporation that manufactures cars, and an officer of the corporation modifies a safety test so that the results are favorable. However, the safety results are actually quite scary, and they reveal that there are some mechanical issues with the cars that would likely cause car accidents and therefore injuries to those people in the vehicle. If the lawyer for the corporation finds out about the fact that the safety tests have been modified, the lawyer must report this information up to the board of directors or that highest entity within the corporation that can take action. The lawyer can also report out if the lawyer believes that this is necessary to protect its client, because falsifying safety tests is a violation of law that would likely cause substantial harm to the corporation. It would likely cause them to suffer financial harm as well as litigation. Turning to the Sarbanes-Oxley Act, this is specific for securities lawyers. When a lawyer becomes aware of credible evidence that their client is materially violating a federal or a state securities law, they must, so this is a mandatory reporting requirement, they must report it to the client's chief legal officer or chief executive officer. This also applies if there is credible evidence that the client's personnel has breached a fiduciary obligation under state or federal law, or has committed a similar material violation under a federal or state law. So again, it's a mandatory reporting requirement that is specific to security lawyers. But the rule doesn't stop there. It goes on to tell us that this obligation continues. It tells us specifically that that CLO or CEO has to then decide if a violation has in fact occurred. And if there has been a violation of state or federal law, then an appropriate response is required to be taken by that person. This means that the CLO or CEO has to take reasonable steps so that the client is taking or making a reasonable response. In other words, action must be taken. If an appropriate response is not taken, then the lawyer must report the evidence to the board of directors. And the lawyer may report this information to the SEC without the client's consent. Any confidential information that is reasonably necessary can be divulged if it's to stop the client from committing a violation that will cause a substantial financial injury to the client or its investors, or to rectify the injury if the lawyer's services were used in the violation. Or lastly, to prevent the client from committing perjury in an SEC matter or any matter within the jurisdiction of any branch of our federal government. So again, it's very similar to the previous rule in that you must report up and you may report out. Same idea here. You must report up to that CLO or CEO. And then there's that additional requirement that a response must be taken and that you may report out to the SEC in those three instances. Moving on to the next portion of our rules, the safekeeping of funds and other property. These rules make up 2 to 8% of your total exam. When a client prepays a lawyer for services or otherwise gives the lawyer property before the lawyer has actually earned that money or property in question, the lawyer has to make sure that they do not commingle it with their own assets. They can't steal it, they can't borrow it, or otherwise use it for their own personal advantage. Thus, if a client gives a lawyer a large amount of funds, The lawyer should make sure that they put this money in a separate account so the client can keep any interest that's earned on it. Now, if the client gives the lawyer a small amount of funds, the lawyer is allowed to take that small amount of funds and put it in an IOLTA account, where other client funds are also kept. In the IOLTA accounts, any interest earned is given to the State Bar Foundation. If there's some sort of disputed claim between the lawyer and the client in the amount of money that is owed or earned, the law tells us that the lawyer must keep the disputed portion in the client trust account until that dispute is resolved. The lawyer shall promptly distribute all portions of the property that are not in dispute. I would break this down into steps. I would say that the lawyer should give back to the client what everyone agrees is the client's money. The lawyer should pay himself what everyone agrees is owed to the client. And the lawyer should hold in trust the amount of money that is in dispute. For example, let's say a lawyer represents a client and bills the client $8,000. The client has prepaid this lawyer $10,000. The client receives the bill and says, "I don't owe you $8,000, I only owe you $7,000. So in this instance, over this disputed claim, the lawyer should pay himself the $7,000 that everyone agrees is at a minimum his. The lawyer should put the $1,000 that's in dispute in trust and then give the $2,000 that remain back to the client. Turning to the next subsection of our rules, communications about legal services. This makes up 4 to 10% of your total MPRE exam. The first rule says that a lawyer may advertise many different ways, through written, media, recorded media, or any other electronic means. When it comes to payment, lawyers shall not give anything of value to a person that recommends their services or for recommending their services, except that lawyers can pay the reasonable costs associated with advertising. They can pay the usual charges of a legal services plan or a not-for-profit qualified lawyer referral service. And they can also pay for a law practice in compliance with these rules. Additionally, lawyers can refer clients to another lawyer or a non-lawyer professional pursuant to the reciprocal referral agreements, so long as these reciprocal referral agreements are not exclusive in nature. The client is informed that one of these agreements exists, and the reciprocal agreement does not interfere with the lawyer's professional judgment in helping his or her client. When it comes to solicitation, the law tells us that lawyers shall not, by in-person, live telephone, or real-time electronic contact, solicit professional employment when a significant motive for them doing so is pecuniary gain, unless the person that they're contacting is another lawyer, is someone that they have a close relationship with, or is a family member, or if they have some sort of prior professional relationship with that lawyer. For example, you can solicit someone if you want to work for free. So let's say you are a lawyer that specializes in constitutional law. And let's say that you find that there is someone in your community who was wrongfully arrested at a protest. You can approach that person and offer to represent them for free. So while that's technically soliciting them because you're going up to them in person and in real time, but because you're offering to work for free, the rules allow you to do so. Now, if you approach them in person and offer to help them, but you want to charge them, this would be in violation of the rule, assuming that it's not the type of person that you're allowed to solicit. Now, when it comes to communications about a lawyer's services, these can't be false or misleading. So let's say that A and B are brand new licensed lawyers, and they take out an ad that says they've never lost a case. Technically, this is true, but it's also misleading, because they've never actually had a case. Thus, this is a problem under these ethical requirements. Therefore, what I want to stress in that example is that the rule uses the word or. So it says that these communications must not be false or misleading. So in my example, the communication wasn't false, but it was misleading, which would amount to an ethical violation. When it comes to law firm names, these too can't be false or misleading. Trade names are allowed to be used for lawyers in private practice so long as they don't imply some sort of connection with a governmental agency or with a public or charitable legal services organization. Turning to our next subsection of the rules, the lawyer's duties to the public and the legal system. This makes up a small subsection of your exam, specifically 2 to 4%. The first rule is that lawyers should render 50 hours of free services per year. The rule says should, so it's important that we should strive for this, but it's not mandatory. When it comes to appointments, the rule states that a lawyer should not seek to avoid appointments from a court to represent a person unless they have good cause to do so. Some examples of good cause would be if you were appointed to represent someone that would result in a violation of these rules. If it's likely to result in some sort of unreasonable financial burden, or if your client's position that you've been appointed to help is so repugnant to you that it would impair your ability to fairly represent that person. Finally, under this subsection, law reform activities. The rules state that a lawyer may serve as a director or an officer or as a member of an organization involved in the reform of the law or its administration, notwithstanding the fact that this reform may affect the interests of a client of the lawyer's. When the lawyer knows that the interest of one of their clients may be materially benefited by a decision of the group in which they are participating, the lawyer shall disclose that fact, but does not have to disclose the identity of the client that would ultimately be benefited. So let me give you a few quick examples. Let's say there's a criminal defense lawyer who handles a lot of DUI cases. And this lawyer also participates in law reform activities, advocating for stricter laws regarding drunk driving and to lower the BAC limit under the law. This is okay because any sort of change that may result is not going to be retroactive, meaning it's not going to harm his past clients. It would only be prospective in nature. Another slightly different example, let's say there's a lawyer that specializes in antitrust litigation, and they also participate with a law reform group on this subject. If there is some sort of decision being made that the lawyer's client is going to materially benefit from, the lawyer needs to tell this group that they have a client that's going to benefit. But the lawyer does not have to give the group their client's name. Now, the final subsection of our rules is all about judicial conduct, and it makes up 2 to 8% of your total exam. So first things first, judges are supposed to be in compliance with the law. They're supposed to be promoting confidence in our judiciary. They're not supposed to be abusing the prestige that's associated with their judicial office. They should avoid things like bias, prejudice, and harassment. Judges shall perform both their judicial as well as their administrative duties competently and diligently. Judges should ensure that there is the right to be heard by every person. When it comes to reporting, this rule is something very similar to one you've already seen. It says that a judge that knows another judge or another lawyer has committed a violation of these judicial rules or of the model rules of professional conduct that applies to lawyers that raises a substantial question as to that judge's or lawyer's honesty, trustworthiness, or fitness in other regards, shall inform the appropriate authority. Thus, the reporting requirement that applies to lawyers that are not judges applies to judges as well. So, judges have to report other lawyers, including judges, when they know that there has been a violation that amounts to that substantial question of that lawyer's honesty, trustworthiness, or fitness. Now, when it comes to disqualification, the law tells us that a judge shall disqualify himself or herself in any proceeding in which the judge's impartiality might reasonably be questioned. And your cheat sheet provides you with a whole bunch of examples. But what I want to stress here is that this list is not exhaustive. Thus, there are situations that may not be on your list, so keep that in mind. One situation regarding disqualification is when the judge has some sort of personal bias or prejudice concerning a party or a party's lawyer, or they have personal knowledge of facts that are in dispute. In this instance, they need to disqualify themselves. To give you an example of this, let's say a judge's longtime ex-girlfriend ended up breaking up with him and married another local lawyer. That lawyer is in front of the judge, and the judge has always hated him for marrying his longtime ex-girlfriend. The judge still hates this lawyer, but he's going to try to keep an open mind. In this instance, this bias is likely grounds for disqualification, and the judge should remove himself from this case. Another situation of disqualification is if the judge is likely to be a material witness in the proceeding, or if the judge knows that the judge or the judge's spouse or their domestic partner or a person within the third degree of relationship to them, their spouse, or their domestic partner is a party to a proceeding that's in front of him or her, is an officer or a director or a partner or a managing member, or a trustee of a party that is in front of him or her, is acting as a lawyer in the proceeding, or has more than a de minimis interest that could be substantially affected by the case. So, to give you an example of this, let's say a judge is hearing a case in which his wife is a lawyer for one of the parties. This is a problem. This is definitely a situation where the judge should disqualify himself. The next situation of disqualification is if the judge knows that he or she, individually or as a fiduciary, or their spouse or their domestic partner, or their parent or their child, or any member of their household that resides with them, has an economic interest in the subject matter, in the controversy, or in part of the proceeding. So let's say that a judge personally banks at ABC Bank, and ABC Bank is being sued. In this instance, the judge is not going to be disqualified from this matter because this is not considered an economic interest. The next situation of disqualification is if the judge knows or learns by means of a timely made motion that a party, the party's lawyer or law firm, or a party's lawyer within the previous years has made a certain number of contributions to the judge's campaign. The next situation of disqualification is if the judge, while they were a judicial candidate or a judge, has made some sort of public statement other than in a decision or in a court proceeding or an opinion that commits or appears to commit the judge to reach a particular result or to rule in a particular way in a controversy. Judges should disqualify themselves if they did any of the following: if they served as a lawyer in the matter or in the controversy, or was associated with a lawyer who participated substantially as a lawyer in the matter during their association. 2, serve in governmental employment and in such a capacity participated both personally and substantially as lawyer or public official concerning the proceeding, or has publicly expressed an opinion concerning the merits of the case. 3, was a material witness in the matter. Or 4, previously presided as a judge over the matter in another court. So to give you a quick example of this situation, let's say before the judge was a judge, he was just a normal lawyer, and his partner at his law practice was Bob Smith. Bob Smith handled all of the personal injury matters that came to the law firm. Now, one of those personal injury matters that was around while the judge was a partner with Bob Smith is in front of the judge. This is a problem, because even though the judge didn't personally handle these cases, he was associated with someone who was handling the case before he was a judge. This would be grounds for disqualification. The next rule is all about acceptance and the reporting of gifts and loans and bequests, or really anything of value. So here the rule says, judges shall not accept these types of things, gifts, loans, benefits, or again, anything of value, if acceptance is prohibited by law, or if it's going to appear to a reasonable person to undermine the judge's independence, integrity, or impartiality. For example, a judge can accept cupcakes for her office and her administrative staff from the local bar association because this doesn't appear to undermine her independence or her integrity or her impartiality to a reasonable person. Instead, accepting cupcakes seems kind of like a nice societal pleasantry or a nice thing to do. It's not necessarily a gift of value. When it comes to a judge's extrajudicial activities, the general rule states that a judge may engage in these types of things. But while they may choose to engage in these types of extrajudicial activities, they may not do the following. They cannot engage in conduct that would appear to a reasonable person to be coercive. They can't make use of the court premises, staff, equipment, or other resources, except if it's some sort of incidental use for activities that concern the law, the legal system, or the administration of justice, or unless use of it is permitted by law. They cannot participate in activities that are going to interfere with the proper performance of their judicial requirements. they cannot participate in activities that would appear to a reasonable person to undermine the judge's independence, integrity, or impartiality. And then they cannot participate in activities that would lead to frequent disqualification from the bench. Now, when it comes to appearances before governmental bodies and consultations with government officials, the rules tell us that judges shall not voluntarily appear at public hearings or otherwise consult with executive or legislative bodies or officials, except in the following instances. First, in connection with matters concerning the law, the legal system, or the administration of justice. The second exception is in connection with matters in which the judge has acquired knowledge or expertise during the course of their judicial duties and responsibilities. Or three, when the judge is acting pro se, meaning representing themselves without a lawyer in the matter involving their own legal or economic interests, or they're acting in a fiduciary capacity. Let's say a judge is being sued by her next door neighbor over a property line dispute. In this instance, the judge can appear in court and represent themselves. This would be completely fine and ethical. Now, when it comes to testifying as a character witness, judges should not do this in really any sort of proceeding, except when they've been summoned under the law. When it comes to appointments to governmental positions, judges are not supposed to be accepting this type of thing, and really any sort of governmental board or position, unless it concerns the law, the legal system, or the administration of justice. And it's usually because these types of tasks and positions are very time-consuming and interfere with the judge's judicial responsibilities. When it comes to the practice of law, a full-time judge should not be practicing law. Now, again, judges can act pro se, like in that previous example. They are allowed to represent themselves. They're also allowed to give legal advice and to draft legal documents for their family members. But they cannot appear as a judge in any forum, even for a family member. Lastly, when it comes to judges and their memberships and different organizations, judges cannot hold memberships in any sort of organization that practices discrimination to any degree, because judges are supposed to be independent and not have any sort of bias. This is inherently problematic. Now, even if a judge is not a member of some sort of organization that has some sort of discriminatory practice, the judge should not be engaging in the use of any of these organizations' facilities or resources. Because again, a judge needs to keep a distance from these types of groups that have discriminatory practices or ways. There is an exception for religious practices, but that is the only exception. Now we have reached the end of our MPRE cheat sheet. Before we part ways, remember, the best approach to being successful on this exam is to first understand the rules. Second, memorize, and you don't want to skip that step. And then third, practice questions. If you have time, please participate in our full MPRE course. Best of luck on your upcoming exam.